Welcome to Mystara with another remaster as I get rid of some old shames with some new fresh shames. This time I'm doing the Elves of Alfheim, the fifth gazetteer written in 1988 by Steve Perrin and Anders Svensson. Get ready for some hot elf-on-elf action, as well as one of the beefier books in terms of new material and background information. And just a few short years after this book came out, TSR destroyed the entire nation and there was nothing the players can do about it. A lot of people still soar over that one. I'm Mr. Welch and it's time to sharpen those ears. Written in 1998 by Steve Perrin of RuneQuest fame and Anders Svensson, also of RuneQuest fame, Alfheim is the elfiest elfland that ever elfed an elf. Seriously, if there was more of a combination of elf tropes in one book, I haven't found it. The cover is classic Caldwell, naturally, with the usual three characters gracing it, though it does continue the style of pants being a human-only thing, as none of the elves seem to sport them at all. Of special note is the dark-skinned elf that was supposed to be a shadow elf, despite their appearance being confirmed with pale skin. Word of God said that this was a miscommunication between Caldwell and the author. The book does return to the 96-page format that Glantry started, after briefly going back to the 64-page format in Irindi. However, it doesn't split into the DM and player sections just yet. The story of Alfheim, like most of Mystara, starts with Blackmoor, because of course just about every ancient story in Mystara starts off with a huge explosion. Alfheim does fill in a large chunk of the Blackmoor story regarding the Great Rain of Fire, so that is a major plus. The original elven homeland was in Grunland, which is now called Vulcania, part of the southern Arctic region. The elves were closely allied with Blackmoor, except a small faction that thought up giving the elven ways for the new cool technological toys was a bad thing. These elves, led by their future patron immortal Ilsendal, decided to leave Grunland and start their own elfland. Then Blackmoor blew up. Grunland got shifted to the bottom of the planet, and everybody else generally had a really bad day. Other elves that survived decided to stay. Little is known about them, though the Belkades elves said their ancestors hung around for another 3 centuries trying to make it work, then headed north as well. The elves that remained, that stayed true to the Blackmoor way of life, were preserved in the Hollow World before they froze to death, trapped as the Blacklore elves forever afterwards. The elves finally made it to the northern part of Brune and settled in a land they called the Sylvan Realm. There were conflicts with the humans who felt the elves had something to do with the Great Rain of Fire, but the elves stayed to themselves and there was peace for a while. Eventually the elves started to run out of space, and rather than fight the humans in the surrounding lands for territory, they sent a large portion of the population through magical portals to find another homeland. Here they arrived in what would become Thyatis in several hundred years, and started migrating to the future Alfheim. Several tribes split off from the main group, settling in various regions of Karamikos, Thyatis, Glantry, and Windar, though the majority stayed with the main group. Arriving in the arid steppes of future Derrickan, the elves asked for, and were given, land to settle by the humans who thought nobody could survive in the barren steppes. Fully expecting the elves to starve to death, humans left them alone to do their own thing, which is exactly what the elves proceeded to do. Only being elves, they couldn't help but enrich their own lives by ruining someone else's. In this case, they used powerful weather magic to steal the rain that was normally destined for the Nithian Empire. The extra water, coupled with elven magic, allowed the elves to create the magical Canalbarth Forest, all the while Nithia and later Yalarum turned into a blasted desert from a once green and verdant plain. The Nithians sent an expedition to figure out where all the hell their water was going, but this expedition was destroyed by elven magics. Within 3 centuries, the Nithian Empire was erased for history by the immortals for a host of sins that are covered in the Nithian Empire video. Alfheim flourished after the fall of Nithia, as they could steal all the water away from the fallen empire and nobody could stop them. The great forest prospered, and soon the Canalbarth was fully grown. An evil wizard conquered the Sylvan realms far to the south, and Alfheim took in the few survivors before they had to cut off the magical portals to their former homeland. With the arrival of Clan Filiadil, the Alfheim clans were complete, though Clan Irindil splintered 100 years later and large portions of the clan relocated to Glantry. The elven population of Alfheim is broken into 7 major clans, with multiple unnamed smaller clans that don't make up a noticeable part of the population. Elves view their clan as more important than their family, for the simple reason that children are rare in Alfheim. There are typically less than 10 toddlers in a clan at any given time. Add to the fact that elven children nurse until they're at least 3 years old, and probably spend a decade in the terrible twos, there's a reason why elves developed birth control about the same time they mastered fire. Children are raised by the clan rather than the parents, because children are vital to a clan and everyone has to chip in to help rear the child. Clan Chosim are the merchants of Alfheim. They were largely responsible for the creation of Alfheim Town, and are even now pushing for merchant routes to the north, east, and west of Alfheim to increase the amount of elven goods in foreign markets. They are the friendliest of clans, but the other clans view them as regressive due to their time in Grunland, when those elves grew too close to the elven ways and were destroyed. Clan Irindel is the ruling clan, led by King Doriath. They are the relatives of Clan Arrowone and Glantry, who relocated there because of its strong magic centuries ago. Unlike other schisms, the two clans are relatively close politically, and Arrowone's loyalty to Glantry is often questioned. Arendil is known for its craftsmen, who sell their creations for high prices to the merchants of Derrican. Other crafters from all over the known world come to learn the Elven method, which does make Arendil one of the richer clans. Clan Feodil is the most recent clan, arriving as refugees from the fall of the Sylvan Realms. Because of this, they are rather distrustful of outsiders, and are known to have a chip on their shoulder because of the guilt they feel for being defeated by the wizard Moorcroft. They have the largest percentage of adventurers, as the clan seems to feel it needs to prove its bravery. They get along with dwarves more than other clans, but they don't trust humans at all except for druids. Clan Grunolf maintains the forest, and represents the best trackers, woodsmen, and boatsmen Alfheim has to offer. They also have the most experience with the Shadow Elves, having been on the receiving end of the Shadow Elf invasion over 400 years ago. Grunolf elves are known for their over-the-top boasting. They love to try and outdo one another given a chance. Because of their skill with the outdoors, Grunolf produces some of the best tree keepers found in Alfheim, one of their few traits they don't openly brag about. Clan Longrunner is the most insular of all the clans, having nothing to do with the outside races, and they even distrust elves outside the borders of Alfheim. They are almost primitive in appearance, preferring leather for their armor and maintaining ancient elven clothing and makeup. The clan leadership does make exceptions for human wizards and druids to help maintain the forest and control the monsters that emerge from the bad magic spot of Stalkbrow. The clan makes extensive use of a use name, or a name they give themselves to keep their actual name secret from outsiders. Even the actual name of the clan in Elven is secret. Longrunner is just the name used by outsiders. They will change their use name over time as their interests change. It's not uncommon for a member of the clan to have several names. The clan is also stolen straight from ElfQuest, with Cutter and Lita representing the clan leaders, only quite a bit taller, and possessing the ability to grow awesome stashes. Well, not Lita. Still, if you're going to steal, steal from the best. Clan Mialadil is the most conservative of all the clans, tracing their heritage back to Alfheim's founder, Meliadin Red Arrow. They also serve as the archivists and historians of the elves, possessing books and scrolls reportedly going all the way back to the time of Blackmoor. They base their decisions off of those of Mialadin, claiming his wisdom still holds true today. They venerate their patron immortal and still dress in ways that were common back when he was still immortal. While they possessed a vast knowledge of the history of the known world, they're also loath to share it with anyone outside their own clan. Clan Red Arrow is the military of Alfheim. They have the distinction of being the most internally ambiguous, as they are not fans of other races and nations, but they're fascinated by their military and tactics. They were once part of Clan Mialadin, serving as elite guards of the then king, but after repelling multiple invasions, their mentality had changed enough to make them their own clan. They located themselves near the largest Derrican settlement at the time of the clan's founding, and have been at the front of every major invasion into Alfheim since. Their clan leaders want to remove Alfheim town, viewing it as a strategic weakness. He has been overruled constantly, as his vision for Alfheim would cripple the nation economically. Being populated by elves, Alfheim is an incredibly magical place. The trees that make up the forest were created by altering existing trees into the enormous sentinel and home trees. Sentinel trees loom above the forest, standing hundreds of feet high and used by the elves as lookout posts for possible dangers. The wood is also quite hard and used in building materials when possible. Home trees possess an oversized gall which can provide a home for up to 20 elves. The elves turn these galls into comfortable homes or use them for other reasons. With the exception of Alfheim Town, all elven towns are found above ground, with ladders and bridges connecting the home and sentinel trees. This makes the elven towns all but impervious to assault, as even fire is of little use against the magic of the sentinel and the home trees. Elves have mastered powerful magics that they call their own, turning normal druidic spells into arcane spells for their own use. It's not a matter of just finding a scroll and learning an elven spell. You have to be taught by an elf personally. The higher level spells can only be learned inside of Alfheim or another elven kingdom, as they're far too complicated for just a single elf to teach. The spells are largely of a nature theme, though the tree keepers do have a large amount of melee and touch spells, as they possess superior fighting abilities compared to other wizards of similar levels. Elves are not the only creatures native to Alfheim. Vast numbers of sylvan creatures such as treants, hasau, and centaurs populate the lower regions of the forest. Many of these races helped create Alfheim at the very beginning of the nation. Alfheim also serves as the primary portal to the Good Kingdom, the land of the Fae connected entirely in the dimension of Faerie. While there are numerous portals from the Good Kingdom to the Prime Material Plane, none are more important than the one found in Dreamland, a good magic spot in southwestern Alfheim. While the Fae swear no allegiance to King Doriath, it is in their best interest to maintain the peace outside of the Candlebarth Forest. There is no more strange citizen inside of Alfheim than the orcs of the Orc Quarter in Alfheim Town. Survivors of a defeated orc invasion over a decade ago, some of the orc prisoners assimilated into elven culture and now work as physical laborers. While they're a strange sight, the elves are protective of them, considering them part of Alfheim culture and won't let outsiders harass them. The largest town in Alfheim was founded on the site of an ancient battle that left the land barren and lifeless. Rather than let the field go to waste, the elves created Alfheim Town, where foreign traders are welcome and embassies were established. It's not the capital. The clans actually meet in Elamir, home of King Doriath, but Alfheim Town is the largest city in Alfheim, dwarfing the clan holds in size. Here the elves sell their wares, and merchants come to unload foreign cargoes. Alfheim Town is run largely by Clan Chosim, though the profits from the various taxes are distributed to help all of the clans. If you're not an elf, you are restricted to Alfheim Town, as visiting other portions of the nation are by invitation only. Sylvan and Fey creatures aren't uncommon in Alfheim Town, visiting more out of curiosity than anything else. Even Archfey have been known to visit the trading post, especially on holidays or cultural events. The entire nation is built around the Elven Tree of Life, a powerful artifact that is possessed by every major clan. All of the trees were created as avatars of the elven patron Ilsendol and given to the original clans that founded Alfheim. Only Clan Feodil's tree is different. It was a cutting from the original tree in the Sylvan Land. The trees are cared for by the elven wizards known as Tree Keepers, who have mastered several druidic spells to help them with this task. Because of their sworn task, Tree Keepers rarely adventure and tend to be lower levels than other elves with the same amount of experience. Their one advantage is the unique spells open to them, mostly for the care and defense of the Trees of Life. The Tree Keepers are the ones that create special elven artifacts from the bark and leaves of the Trees of Life, some of the most sacred possessions that the Sylvan Elves can earn. Crafting these artifacts take decades, and awarding them are a major event in Alfheim. Visitors will find the Sylvan Elves highly pragmatic in the ruling of their nation. Punishments for outsiders are largely restricted to exile or death, as they have no prison and they have little need for foreign coin from offenders. Elves will not think twice about using magic to garner the information from suspects or witnesses. Resisting mental interrogation is considered suspicious and will be used against you. Alfheim uses Derrickan for governmental roles they find beneath them, such as creating currency or maintaining the roads into Alfheim Town. While Derrickan is Alfheim's closest ally, the elves only assist their neighbor in times of great danger, believing everything outside their borders is a human problem. So why do you want to play a Sylvan Elf from Alfheim? They're known for their arrogance, they care a little for outsiders, many of them are distrustful of visitors, and a few of them even dislike elves of other clans. However, the various clans have their own unique traits, giving players a variety of options to play an Alfheim elf. The lack of a monolithic culture among the elves mean you can have a party of elves and all of them have a different approach to life. While a character is never tied to the background of his culture, at least partially keeping with the stereotype of their clan gives them something to build around. A militant Red Arrow elf, a mercantile Chosim, an arcane Meliodil might all have different approaches to the same problem, but they're all loyal to Alfheim first. Finding a physical copy of Elves of Alfheim isn't cheap. With the map, you're looking at around $60 on average, and the map is difficult to acquire in the first place. There's no DM's Guild version in print, and only a PDF for $5. Other books dealing with Alfheim include Tall Tales of the Wee Folk and The Module Tree of Life, both of which are also hard to track down as originals, though Tree of Life is on POD. Next up on the list of remasters is the Dwarves of Rockholm, who were some of the dwarfiest dwarves to ever dwarf a dwarf. But until then, remember, if the elf is rolling badly, it doesn't mean you need to water him.